Wow, welcome. We're going to have some fun here, some camaraderie, and you never know what else, because we don't have any script. We don't have to finish our sentences, our thoughts, our concepts, our explanations at all. Reality is not dependent upon us scripting it somehow. And yet we are in this wow situation, right? Very interesting situation. Not to be thought of too much. We have to more and more breathe the air of authenticity. So, this is what frees us up from the overwhelming intensity that just locks onto us and we can hardly breathe. Breathe the air of authenticity and allow the wow. Allow the wow. Realize you're in the wow. I'm in the wow. We are. We're in the wow. This present, the tone of the present culture, world culture, is not our friend at all. It's completely abandoned any pretense of even being our friend. And this is what is unnerving us. We say, oh my gosh, we need a friend. Well, let wow be your friend. Really, let wow be your friend for now. And from wow unto wow unto wow. Okay. So, welcome to the video. And we have our second graphic up there that I promised I would try to put a graphic up every day. And gradually, you know, from wow unto wow unto wow unto wow unto wow. And just say, hey, my glass is always half full now. It's always half full. There's nothing I can do about it. I have a new friend. I have a new friend. See, culture isn't your friend. Pharmaceutical culture is not your friend. The lipstick culture, lipstick and pajama boy culture is not your friend. Okay, those are all militant. They belong to the church militant of the pharmaceutical culture. And they're not our friends. They're not even their own friends. And we have to remind them of this, you see, that the ego is nobody's friend. Okay. And the way the ego markets itself as the goddess, and then the goddess pharmaceutical culture, and then the militant lipstick pajama boy culture comes from that. And the ego is nobody's friend. Okay. So we're just here to allow the air of authenticity into the world. That's all. That's all. Just let it be here. Jesus is here. He's just authenticity. That's all. He's not trying to prove anything. He doesn't need to prove anything. So, just being. Just the being, the authenticity of being. That's all. Do we have to finish? Do we have to have cohesive, you know, concepts? We have to have cohesive concepts for truth to be true. We have to say, well, truth is true, you know. Well, yes, it is, but do we have to think that? You see, do we have to think this? Is it actually something we have to think, or is it true, regardless of our thinking? You know, and does our thinking cloud it over for us, because it's beyond what concepts can really shed light upon at all? How can we shed light upon light? You know. So, we just, you know, let's make wow our friend for now. Let's walk together in the wow. There's nothing wrong with that. As we breathe the air of authenticity. Every day we want to go bigger, get more air of authenticity. And I was able to do that today. Fortunately, somehow, the Holy Spirit always manages to get it done. Okay, so if you're just getting to it every day is more authenticity, then, you know, you're getting it done. And don't worry, you're just going from wow unto wow unto wow, and your glass is half full, and it's getting fuller all the time. And don't worry about explaining this. You see, this is what is frightening. As the farther along you go, then you think, well, how the heck am I going to explain this? You know, to who? To the ego? To the ego? So part of the whole situation is realizing you don't have to explain anything to the ego. But the ego is expert at putting you on the defensive, like you're supposed to explain. So we have a little fun with explanation here, you know, and breathe the air of authenticity. Who does reality need to explain itself to? You know, this is the question, right? Okay. Wow. We really are in the wow phase right now. And what is that? Well, you know, what is it? We don't have to worry about explaining anything to the ego. Christology, Christology, Christology. Now, the Holy Spirit turned my attention to this and says, you know, get up to speed on this. And I was like, I'll have to speed on it. I said, okay, I'm up to speed on it, you know. And it doesn't take me long at all. You know, and because I realize I don't have to cater to the ego. So the ego says, well, explain this, explain this, explain this. You know, I said, don't have to. But could I? Sure. Do I, you know, I'll do what I do what the Holy Spirit wants me to do. Do I have to explain it? I mean, can I understand all the, you know, the controversies and the words that they use and all this kind of stuff? Sure. Hypostatic union, you know, and the, that's the big one, right? The hypostatic union, Theotokos, the, you gotta have that, you know, that is very important. So the apostolic, the Christology obsessed the early Christians up for about 700 years, and it's still obsessing them. But after the Chalcedon Council, the Ecumenical Council at Chalcedon, which is just on the Asian side of the Straits of Bosporus, which is, of course, from the Black Sea into the Sea of Marmara, something like that. And Constantinople is on the European side of the Straits of Bosporus. So the, you know, Chalcedon was the big council where they think they solved everything, okay? Because they had all these disagreements. All these disagreements. Chalcedon. 451, Council of Chalcedon. And what happened was there were schisms. All these schisms. Everybody was trying to explain the Christology, which is the nature of Jesus, and what was Jesus in relation to God. I mean, what really happened? What really happened? And they were just have all these different ideas. You know, adoptionism, Arianism was an early heresy, and Arianism said, well, Jesus was a man, but then he was adopted by God by being so perfect and righteous, or something like that. And then ultimately there was Nestorianism. It's difficult to explain. They were like splitting hairs and desperately trying to figure out, you know, how do we explain? Let's get all on the same page. Now, keep in mind that this was that Christianity arose in a Hellenized Greco-Roman Empire. Okay, Antioch, the cradle of Christianity was in Antioch. Now, Antioch was founded by Alexander the Great, and it was the architects laid it out very beautifully on the Orontes River, which flows north out of the mountains of Lebanon, and just in the northwestern part of Syria. So Antioch, we think, what's Antioch? Well, Antioch was the biggest city in the world. Alexandria took over that position at some point, and then Rome, but Antioch was 500,000 people. Sophisticates. Okay, this was the center of Greco-Roman culture. And this is where Peter and Paul and the apostles, they hung out there. This is they had a Jewish community there, a Hellenized Jewish community, which means that they spoke Greek. They were trained in Greek. They sent their children to Greek school. I mean, these were, you know, very, very sophisticated people. Now, when you have an empire, you want standardization. You want standardized currency, for one thing, right? So the Christians wanted to standardize their beliefs, so wherever you went, you were on the same page, and it could be run like an empire. So you had different theorists trying to theorize what was Jesus? Yeah, what was going on here? Now, let's cut to the chase, and let's just say that none of them got it right, okay? To throw a whole, you know, curveball in here, maybe a knuckle curve, but yeah. None of them got it right. Okay, let's fast forward to right now and what I'm saying. With apostolic authority, none of them got it right at all. Okay, so we have been spinning our wheels for 2,000 years, actually. What happened in the Council of Chalcedon was that there was a schism that had arisen between Cyril of Alexandria and Nestor of, where was Nestor from? I think it was either from Constantinople or Antioch, one of the two. And It was a big schism, and they had to resolve it because they wanted standardization. This is what empires do, standardize. So they got together in this ecumenical council, all the people in the world, stands for ecumenical, the people of the world, all of the people of the world. The bishops came in there, and they hashed it out, and they made a compromise, and one of the guys got his holy see back, his area of, they made a deal. They made a deal. It's like, this politics. Said, how do we satisfy this faction? Dester got labeled a heretic and got expelled. He went on to establish the Eastern Church, which actually proselytized all through Central Asia, all the way to China, India, Iran, the whole Persian Empire. I mean, it was the Church of Thomas, I think, in Goa is still part of the Nestorian Church. So there's actually this huge schism at that point. And Nestor lost, and the council decided for Cyril of Alexandria. Now, very interesting, though, this whole situation. I'll put it in perspective for you, for everybody. The whole problem, well, not the whole problem, but let's say the central problem with the Chalcedonian Creed really tried to deal with, and they got this creed, which is gibberish, actually. It's obvious it's gibberish. They're trying to forge some sort of compromise, and it's just absolute gibberish. But this is the creed that Christianity has lived by for like 1,500 years now. Okay, no wonder why Christianity has become is super vulnerable to this invasion by cosmic corporate culture and technology and the technocracy, fascist technocracy. Because they've been following a false creed all along, all right? The Chalcedonian Creed is nonsense. And the whole thing about Cyril of Alexandria, Alexandria was, of course, the seat, the high seat of ancient culture and sophistication and all of that on the northwestern part of the Nile Delta, a little bit west of the Nile Delta there on the Sea of the Mediterranean. And it was an apostolic see, meaning that one of the apostles, it may have been Mark that founded that one, I'm not sure, one of the apostles. And see, it doesn't really matter, does it, right? Truth is still true. And a lot of power, a lot of authority. And so a lot of politics involved. Cyril won out in the Council of Chalcedonia. And his whole thing was the Theotokos, Mother of God principle. And he insisted that that there has to be a Mother of God, period. And this is what the Nestorians were, they said, no, this is not so necessary, what you're saying. So what they really did was they said, we have to see Jesus Christ in a way, we have to have Christology in a way that makes it absolutely set in stone that Mary was the Mother of God. Okay, this is called Theotokos in Greek. This is, so what was important to them was not Jesus, but Mary, okay, the Mother of God, the goddess, which is the marketing face of the ego, actually. And so they just then tried to cobble Jesus, into that context. And it's just gibberish. It's just gibberish. I mean, I had a good laugh when I read the Chalcedonian Creed, And this is along with, of course, the Nicene Creed, which is earlier adopted. But the Chalcedonian Creed settled the Christology debate for two natures. Jesus was both divine and man. Perfectly divine and perfect man. Okay, that way then you could have Mary be the mother of the perfect man, the mother of God, so to speak. This is what they had to come up. They came up with a dualistic compromise. Chalcedonian Creed. Here it is, the key section. Let me read this. It says, follow then the holy fathers. We all unanimously teach, except for, of course, the Nestorians who were banished as heretics. So, following then the Holy Fathers, we all unanimously teach that our Lord Jesus Christ is to us one and the same Son, the self-same perfect in Godhood, the self-same perfect in manhood, truly God and truly man, truly God and truly man, the self-same of a rational soul and body, co-essential with the Father according to the Godhead, the self-same co-essential with us according to the manhood, like us in all things, sin apart, before the ages begotten of the Father as to the Godhead, but in the last days the self-same for us and for our salvation, born of Mary the Virgin, Theotokos, means Mother of God, to the manhood. One and the same Christ, Son, Lord, only begotten, acknowledged in two natures, unconfusedly, unchangeably, indivisibly, inseparably, the difference of the natures being in no way removed because of the union, but rather the properties of each nature being preserved, and both concurring into one person and one hypostasis, not as though he were parted or divided into two persons, but one and the selfsame Son, and only begotten God, Word, Lord Jesus Christ, even as from the beginning the prophets have taught concerning him, and as the Lord Jesus Christ himself hath taught us, and as the symbol of the Father hath handed down to us. It makes perfect sense, right? Of course. How could we not understand that?
Yeah.
You ever seen a funnier attempt at stuffing a round pig into a square hole? They had to get the Theotokos, Mary, the Mother of God, in there, didn't they? And then they tried to say, well, what? How do we, you know, flim-flam the rest of it around, you know, to make, so that's in there. And it's just, it's absurd. Who could not have laughed at that? And who forgot to laugh at that? Okay, this is the question. This is the question. The bishops forgot to laugh at that. You know, that's been the problem for 2,000 years. We've forgotten to laugh at absurdity, right? If the bishops would have, they should have just roared and laughed. This is hilarious. You know, this is like absolutely hilarious. Thank you very much. Okay, now let's get back to business here. So finally, we're able to laugh at this. I'm sure Jesus must make him feel quite hilarity there, just like, I mean, really, it's like comic book or something. And yet this has been guiding Christianity since it was adopted, you know. And we've been trying to, like, you know, something is wrong here. I mean, what's going on? Now, as I've said, none of Christology has solved the problem at all. Nestor didn't solve it either. None of them did. It's taken us 2,000 years, and Jesus finally had to write A Course in Miracles and say, hey, can somebody please, you know, let's study this. Can we get to the truth finally, you know? And finally we have. So we can render all that null and void. The church age is over. It never began. It never really began. It never was on the right track in the first place. The Christology is completely messed up. I mean, there's all sorts of schisms, you know, within schisms, within schisms, within schisms, and on and on and on and on. Nitpicking this, nitpicking that, nitpicking that. And ultimately, the fighting got so fierce. I mean, you know, the backstabbing, the politics, and the fighting, the deal-making was just incredible back then. And this is what they came up with this, you know, this ridiculous statement. Look, the answer is, nobody's ever been born. Okay. The body, as Jesus says, is wholly neutral. The body is wholly neutral. Everything is simply projected upon the body. Well, there is no human nature. So they kept thinking, how do we put human nature in the ego? So you got to put human nature in. And Mary's, you know, the one who gave birth to perfect human nature. So, you know, the ego goddess, you know, is co-redeemer with Jesus and is part of reality, you know, and that has to be one, but we can't figure out. Well, all this is easily resolved by understanding that spirit is merely pretending to be dead. And this pretending to be dead takes on what we call flesh, human nature, etc. But none of that is substantial. It's all completely insubstantial, the same way as a dream is insubstantial. Let me ask this question. When you have a dream and you're dreaming that you're in a body in a dream and stuff, what kind of human nature does that body have? What kind of nature does that body have in a dream? wouldn't you say it's actually completely insubstantial? And yet when you're dreaming, you think it's completely substantial. There's a world there and stuff, and yet, poof, you wake up from the dream. Where's the substance of it? Where's the substantiality of it? So they just didn't get it. And it's time, I'm saying it right here now, and everybody can have a good laugh if they think I'm, who is this guy saying this stuff? Go ahead, have a good laugh. It's good for everybody to have a good laugh. Just don't judge against the truth. If you feel that, just go into neutral mode. Don't judge for it. If you can't judge for it, perfect. Don't judge against it. All you have to do is not judge against it, and it will automatically dawn upon you. So, yeah. I was determined in this world to resolve all these schisms, all these debates, all this confusion in Christianity, and I've done it. So that was my aim, and what a headache, what an absolute headache. And you can't really go at it directly. You don't have to get bogged down in hypostasis. What the heck is hypostasis? Well, you know what? It's a word that pretty much means believe what we say, because that's the only way we can get the mother of God in there, That's what it really means. It doesn't have any meaning in particular. It just says the magical solution that, cements us all together and lets us have our cake and eat it too. And lets us keep pretending to be dead, except we're redeemed too somehow. Oh my God, there's just the headaches, and the schism's been continue to go on and on, but they finally standardized it so we could, have an empire and spread it throughout the world, because how could you spread it throughout the world if all these people are arguing all the time? Then people say, wow, I don't know what to believe. One group says this, another group says this. So in order, they wanted to standardize it. This is the mindset of the empire, standardize it. So they came up with this ridiculous statement, Chalcedon Creed. Now, yeah. Wow, right? Let's go back to, wow, Jesus is like coming back into the world. And it's like, I just read this creed to him. He says, oh, wow, that again? Are you kidding? Oh, yeah. Wow. What tomfoolery is that? There's only the divine. There's no birth. There's no human nature. There's no bodies. There's nothing. The body is just a neutral symbol that we're just using like a blackboard to project all these fake needs, which is what we're really projecting, is we're projecting that spirit is dead. That's all we're doing. God, there's no mother of God. Okay, there is no mother of God. Wow. There is no mother of God whatsoever. There is no two natures whatsoever. And this is what monophysitism or something, like there's only one nature. But then how do we get the human nature? How do we get Mary, mother of God, in there? How do we do this again? You can't have that, But even that doesn't understand the situation so well. If you just look at it and realize that this whole situation is spirit pretending to be dead in order to try and convince guilt that it's paid the price for killing God, and once it's paid the price, then it can be, greater than God. So guilt will think it's dead. So, oh, spirit died too. Okay, that must have really happened then. Spirit must have really killed God because spirit died too. And then so that sort of established this sort of ontological fact. You can't even use the word, maybe they'll say hypostatic fact, because hypostatic means whatever you want it to mean. That spirit did successfully change the will of God, kill God, because spirit died too, because spirit's one with God, extension of God, God's mind, an idea in the mind of God. So God died, spirit died, there's the proof. And then spirit will somehow then, once that's established as a fact, then spirit will suddenly magically arise from this, like a phoenix from the ashes, and be reborn as the new creator. This is the idea that we're aiming for, that the ego and its marketing face, the goddess, is trying to get us towards totally dying to our authenticity, you see? And then once we die to authenticity, even though we have this, plastic, inauthentic, robotic state, once we die to ourselves, then guilt will be the fact will be established that we did change the will of God, and then somehow that'll metamorphosize into a resurrection as life, and we'll be the prime creator. You see, this is what we're trying to do. It doesn't work. It doesn't work at all. So you don't need the mother of God in there at all. And they, you know, Cyril was absolutely, you know, they made deals. They made deals. I'll do this. I'll restore. If you agree with me, don't oppose me. And I put this in, then I'll restore, you know, you were banned from your apostolic see or whatever. I'll restore you to that. And so I said, okay, let's make a deal, right? So the Christology was pretty much, you know, what was like a political deal, you know? What is that? What a joke. And so we're now finally laughing at this joke. Very much laughing at the joke. They just, you know, they didn't have the right premise. So they were trying to find, you know, right explanation from a false premise. There is no such thing as human nature. So how can Jesus become man, become flesh? It's impossible. It's just the same thing like in a dream. Is a dream of flesh, is that something true and substantial? It has nothing. It's nothing but a quaint whim, our imagination run riot. It's a pretense. This world is 100% a pretense. So what was Jesus here? Well, he was pretending to be here. He was just pretending without being fooled that it's anything other than a pretense. So all you can say about Jesus is that, of course, Jesus is completely divine, as are we already. And Jesus was simply pretending to be here with being fully aware that this entire situation was just a pretense. That's all. That's your Christology right there. End of the debates. End of all the schisms. And what are we doing? We're pretending to be here. Okay, except we're denying that we're pretending to be here. That's the only difference. Okay. Jesus was pretending to be dead, but he wasn't. He knew it was just a pretense. Here's a body. I'm talking with you. I'm acting like a dead spirit, you know. But I'm not really. I know it's just a complete pretense, and at any moment I can drop that pretense. Oh, a miracle. Wow. You know, people said, why'd you do that? I said, well, I know I'm pretending, so I'm not bound by this, you see. I'm not defensive. I'm not defending the pretense. I'm still completely free. When you're completely aware that you're just pretending and you don't need to, but you're doing it out of compassion to come here to communicate, then you can drop the pretense. You're flexible, completely flexible, do miracles, whatever. So that's it. And we're pretending to be dead, except we're saying, no, we really are dead. There's no pretense. We really are dead, you know. So when they insist on the Theotokos, the Mother Mary, the Mother of God, what they're really saying, we insist that, no, this flesh really is, you know, it's real. I mean, the spiritual death is real. We're not pretending. It's real. I mean, we have a mother that made us that way. we were born this way. This is the origin. Mother Mary's the origin of this flesh, and it's real. And try to raise her into the same, you know, status of divinity as pretense. You know, pretense, same status of reality. Say no. We have nothing to do with it. It's the Mother Mary. Mother is the mother of God. She's the mother of the true manhood, the true human nature and stuff. This is the problem, right? They couldn't admit that this is all just nothing but a pretense, all of it, without any exception. So, you know, they saw completely screwed up from the very beginning, as Jesus knew it would be. And by God, the back and forth, and so, you know, a lot of people now just say, oh my God, I don't know, I'll just go to church and listen and, okay, and try to be a good person, and, you know, that's it. And because they just feel like, you know, okay, it's set in stone, because everyone's been just using this creed, you know, for all, you know, the last 1500 years. Okay, it's not set in stone. It's not set in anything. It's a joke. Okay, it's a joke, and we got to start remembering to laugh. But, you know, but it's not mean-spirited laughter at all. It's just lighthearted. Oh, thank God we're not trapped in that anymore, you know. How silly that was. Oh my gosh, I was using a wrong premise and insisting to get right conclusions out of a wrong premise. Okay. So, yeah, we don't need to explain anything more, did we? We just explain what the truth is, you know? And we don't have to chase down every single bizarre compromise that ego comes up with, right? Because it's never ending. It's never ending. Never ending. All we have to do is understand this is all a pretense. That's it. That's it. No harm, no foul. This pretense has not touched our nature whatsoever. It hasn't done anything to us. You see, this is another thing they wanted to think. Well, this is, you know, we have to have done something to God, to Spirit. I mean, we have to have sinned. That's why we have this sinful nature. No, we never sinned. There's no such thing as sinful nature. We didn't change the will of God. We did not change the will of God. But we say, well, look at this whole world, and we're just a little body in this world. No, we dreamed all this up. When we have to go to sleep, have a dream, don't we dream up a whole landscape, a world, the whole area that we're experiencing the dream? Isn't that all? We're dreaming all of that up? Or are we only dreaming the person that's walking? Someone else is dreaming all the rest of the stuff. No, we're dreaming all of it up. The entire stage. We dream the entire stage, and we're just identifying with, like, maybe more identify with a person on the stage doing stuff. But we're also dreaming the audience, the stage, everything in the dream we're dreaming. This is the mind at work. And this tips us off. We say, hey, wait a minute. If I can do that with my mind every night when I go to sleep, how can we say that the mind doesn't have the creative power to actually dream a whole world, an entire universe, actually? Its mere appearance is completely insubstantial. It's not bound at all. It's completely free, actually. We can, at any instant, we can change the dream, can't we? Or even set it down for something, for some other experiencing. So, it's the end of the church age. This is it. It's finished. It's finished. We know I already excommunicated the Pope. Because yeah, he's finished. The apocalypse has already happened to him, big time. This is happening to everybody right now. Right? This is the apocalypse. I mean, St. Paul spoke the apocalypse on the way to the road to Damascus, which was a center of Hellenized Jews. A lot of them Christians. Early, the term Christian first was used in Antioch, actually. And so he's on the way to Damascus, and he has this epiphany where the veil is lifted. He called it apocalypse of Christ. And the veil was lifted for him, and he had a profound change from the Pharisaical perspective that he previously had. Although he didn't drop all the stuff, you know, he still held on to some of it, but he really had a tremendous awakening there. He called it the apocalypse, lifting of the veil. Suddenly he saw what had been previously hidden. So we're seeing now lifting of the veil in these times, and it's kind of like, wow, it's amazing theater. You know, just enjoy it. Get your popcorn. I got popcorn today. What was it? Sweet and salty. I got some sweet and salty. I've got some different kinds of popcorn. Yeah, I really did. I got popcorns, potato chips and ice cream and lemonade, and I'm just sitting back enjoying the show. So make sure you have your popcorn and relax and laugh at the whole thing. That's what I'm helping us breathe the air of authenticity here, you know, where it's like, oh, okay, you mean somebody has figured it out? Yes, I have it figured out. Okay, so you can relax. You know, I did the heavy lifting. Okay, it's already done. So heavy lifting's already done, so relax. The whole thing has been swept away. I had a dream last night where someone was working on this house, and been working for so long on this house. It's a very intense dream. And suddenly, he just pushed the house, with his foot. He just pushed it with his foot like that, his leg. The entire house fell off this little plateau, and it just fell down this flat area and just collapsed. And it collapsed into this absolute flatness. Absolute flatness. The entire structure of this big, big house collapsed into absolute flatness. And I saw it and I said, wow, wow. It was such an intense wow moment. Now, he had been working on loosening this house from the, you know, from the foundation, or, you know, to this for a long time. He was working his whole life, I guess, on this. And then it happened, collapsed, flat. Wow. And then I decided, you know what, I'm going to start clapping. And I started clapping. I said, yeah, yeah, applause, applause. I started giving an applause. And then I heard others start giving an applause. And before you know it, there was this whole circle of applause around this event. And people were applauding and applauding and applauding. You know, it wasn't a huge audience, but there were people all over. And I take this to symbolize the world. People all over the world were starting to applaud this. And I kept applauding and kept applauding and kept applauding. I didn't stop. I said, wow, that is absolutely fabulous. Look at what you just did. It's done. It's done. And all we have to do is applaud, you know, just applaud the fact that it's done. Just be happy. Wow. We're free. We're free of this insanity that we have been caught up in for so long. And we, you know, we had to do it this way for some reason. So just don't forget to applaud. That's all. You know, I started the applause and others started applauding. And there's a whole bunch of people all around a circle, you know, applauding this and say, wow, I really, this is great. Finally. Only took me, you know, 59 years. Flat as a pancake. I mean, flatter than flat. Completely flat. There was no depth to it whatsoever. Completely flat. You know, the lies don't have any depth to them, really, right? So, you know, our minds back then were struggling with continuity fear, and we weren't able to see it properly. If anyone did, they would have been excommunicated and thrown down in a cistern, you know, like Judah was. They had to somehow try and fit it all together. They couldn't just say, wait, this is just all pretense in the very beginning. It's completely meaningless. None of this has any meaning. God doesn't have anything to do with this. This is an attempt to destroy God, actually. It is. It's an attack upon God, but it's an attack without any effects. So, you know, is it meaningful? No, it's not. So what do we do with it? We just laugh. What else can we do but laugh? Okay, to go over it again. We, Spirit, Son of God, the one and only, just one Son, one sonship, which is the extension of God. It's God's mind. You can say it's an idea in the mind of God. Extension of God is an idea in the mind of God. God's the prime creator. God had the idea of extension, but we, Spirit, sonship, is the extension of God. And we are adventurous. We like to play with ideas. So we play with the idea that maybe we can be the prime creator. Okay? So we tried to play with that idea, and nothing happened. And we said, whoa, this is terrible. We got to have evidence that something happened. So we concocted this scheme where we think, well, if something happened, that actually would mean that God would be annihilated, because God's will is one. It's not parts to it. You can't change part of it. It's all just one. So you'd have to change all of it. It would all have to be gone. So to change the will of God means God's gone. But since we're an idea in the mind of God, we would be gone too. So he said, you know, if we can fake our death, you know, if we can be convinced that we invented this something called guilt that we could convince. We said, if God died, that means we have to die too. But if we die too, that would prove that God died. But who do we prove our death to? You see, if we die, who do we prove it to? I said, oh, guilt. So we imagine there's something called guilt that demands our death and is waiting for it. And then once we prove our death to guilt, guilt will say, oh yeah, you did indeed die. He says, so we imagined, we invented guilt. But you see, this death is pretense. That we're pretending, this world of flesh, time, space, process, and form. We're pretending to die. So we think that once we convince guilt that we've died, then guilt will say, indeed, this is a fact. You know, I'm the judge. Guilt's the ultimate judge. We invented this ultimate judge that can discern whether spirit died or not. And guilt will say, indeed, spirit has died, which would then mean that so did God. God died too. See, because we're one. If the idea in the mind of God can die, then the mind of God must have died also, actually. So once we guilt judges, yes, indeed, spirit has died, we can say, ah, you see, God did die, truly, and therefore I had a greater will than God, as they will change the will of God. And at that point, we feel that there's going to be a magical resurrection from having died, and will now be fully alive as the new prime creator, having usurped the place of God. This is what's really going on. So we're trying to convince a non-existent guilt that we died. And this flesh and this body, all this stuff, is just a dream. It's our imagination, trying to convince this non-existent judge who's supposed to be able to discern whether we died or not, that we indeed did die. And that's the whole ball of wax right there. That's the whole ball of wax. Now, none of these dear brothers understood that. Or at least they were not able to express it, or it didn't carry the day, or whatever, right? But bottom line is, this is not what we've been getting, you know. This is not the Christianity we've been getting for 2,000 years, is it? Not the Judeo-Christian Christianity, I mean. The early Christians were Jews, right? And it spread out through the Gentiles. Paul's letter to the Galatians, for instance, was to the Gentiles. Galatia was like an area of sort of like central Turkey, Asia Minor, Anatolia. They call it Turkey now. And they're actually Gauls. They call it Galatia because these were Gauls, which were Gauls, you know, France, Belgium, Switzerland, you know, the Gallic tribes, which were, I think, what, an offshoot of the Celts. And these Gauls eventually... And the people were very mobile back then, you know. I don't know, it's amazing. They actually, a lot of them migrated into central Turkey. So there's a large settlement of Gauls there called Galatia, province of Roman Empire. And so these Gauls were backsliding into paganism very severely. Very, very severely. And Paul, you know, back to the law of Moses, they said, wow, you know, the law is going to save us. And so Paul was writing these letters. He visited, I think, Galatia, and he wrote letters, hey, my brothers, you know, in Christ, you know, don't backslide into the law. Christ, the law was only a temporary expedient, but now we don't need it. Christ is here, and he came here, and he saved us from the law. So he's writing to the Galatians, the pagans there. There was a lot of movement in the, you know, there's one thing we don't realize in the ancient times. People were migrating and moving all the time. It was just amazing. Alexander the Great, he founded all these cities. Cities weren't there. He conquered the area. He said, I'm going to put a city right here. And the architects drew a plan. They started building a city right then and there. He built cities all over. And what he did was to colonize, we got a city, but no people. So, you know, what they did was they took people from other areas of the empire and literally moved them into these new cities. How are we doing here? It froze up on me. You never know about this technology. They'd move them, they'd populate these new cities with people from other areas so that the local population was not the people that populated these new cities. Now, why is this important? Because these people from all different areas of the empire were there. They felt isolated. They weren't part of the population. They had different customs and stuff. They'd been Hellenized already, which means to take Greek customs, etc. And so then they had this unique, they were part of the empire, and they didn't get assimilated into the local customs at all, right? So they remained very loyal to the Greek empire. Very clever tactic. So, tremendous amount of movement of people in those times. And there was a lot of Jews. Well, of course, the Jews, the temple, you know, the destruction of the second temple happened in, 70 AD. And the Jews went all over the place, Damascus, Antioch, a huge population of Jews in Antioch. Oh, was it 100,000 or something? I mean, it was very large. And, you know, a lot of them spoke Greek as their primary language. Some spoke Hebrew. Huge population of Jews, maybe the largest population of all, was in Alexandria. So Christianity was thriving in the Jewish diaspora in these various, you know, other cities. And the apostles were talking to these early Christians who were Jewish, and then the Gentiles, you know, began to be allowed in. I think the Council of Jerusalem decided that, right? Where it said, okay, Gentiles don't have to be circumcised. They don't have to, you know, they just make sure they don't eat meat with blood in it. You know, they relax the rules so the Gentiles could be admitted into the church. But wow, you know, the history of all this is just, you know, constant like this and this and this and this and this, and this, and this, and this. But it doesn't matter, because this is all pretense. It's all pretense. So we let's not lose sight of the forest because of the trees. If we're trying to, you know, keep judging all these trees, you know, we're going to stop realizing, hey, there's just a forest here. You know, there's just a judgment I need. Oh, just a forest. I don't need to get lost in this forest at all. It's a forest of pretense is all it is. You know, so why sweat the details? You know, the categorizing aspect is the ego. Of labeling, detailing, categorizing. You know, the ego says, well, what? I need to categorize my mistakes. It's like somebody who's like pretending to be blind. You close your eyes and you'd say, wow, I can't see anything. What is this? What is this? You know, what is this? Oh, okay, I'm not seeing this. This is something I'm not seeing. And go around, okay, what is this? What is this? Oh, this is something I'm not seeing. What is that over there? And touch this. Oh, that is something I'm not seeing. And there's something I'm not seeing too. And so imagine if a blind person went around, all they did was categorize these things. They kind of feel it. What is it? Okay, name it. Say, okay, this is a door. I'm not seeing this door. And I'm, what are you doing? You'd ask them. They say, well, I'm categorizing all the things I can't see. I say, why don't, and you say, why don't you just open your eyes? And then, you know, you won't have to worry about categorizing anything. Yeah, this is the situation we're in. We're like blind, but people, like, we've got our eyes closed, pretending to be blind, and we're categorizing all the stuff that we can't see, and then recategorizing it, and organizing it, and constantly shuffling and thinking that somehow I'm going to be satisfied if I just organize all the stuff that I can't see properly. If I just, you know, like somehow everything's going to, I'm gonna be happy. Even though I can't see anything, I'll be happy if I just have the right organization in my mind, like in the right labels of all the stuff I can't see. There's a tree I can't see, and there's a road I can't see, and there's all these different cars that I can't see, and all the stuff I can't see, any of that. Okay, now I've organized it right. Okay, now I'm happy. I feel great. Everything's fine. Everything's perfect. Really? And so all we say is just dismiss all this nonsense and say, look, cut to the chase. Well, just open your eyes. And, you know, that's the end of all this nonsense, right? But the ego says, no, wait, I still, you know, how am I going to categorize all the stuff I can't see if I can see? You know, I won't be able to do it. This is the folly that we have right now, the absolute folly that we have. Just like that, worse than that. I mean, it's ridiculous. We think we got to stay blind in order to categorize everything that we can't see. How else can we be happy? But we bring it back to the real dynamic, which is we're trying to convince guilt that we're dead. And guilt doesn't exist. There is no judge. There isn't. We just completely invented such a dynamic. Doesn't exist at all. There is, you know, we call it the I, call it the me, something that realizes that we're dead, you know, that spirit died. There isn't any such judge. So we're trying to convince non-existent judge, you know, that we died. It's like trying to convince zero that we're zero too. Hey, zero, you know, we're also zero, you know. How do you convince nothing that you too are nothing? Good luck at that. So this is the nonsense that we're engaged in. And, you know, they fail to realize that nonsense. They're all sweating it out, trying to say, good Lord, you know, Jesus must be a man, the way, and he's divine, but he's also man. And how do we, there's a union of the two. No, there's no union, but there's a hypostaticness there. One substance is mystically the way it is without being, but it's still two distinct natures. And it's yet blah, blah, blah. You just heard the Chalcedon Creed. Basically, they're saying, you know, let's just make it so indecipherable that everybody thinks they got what they want and call it good. You know, this was not a, like a compromise. You know, the way the mind ego compromises is just to make a statement that nobody can understand, and then everybody can feel like, well, I understand it. I mean, I got what I want, right? Did you get what you want? Yeah, I got what I want too. It's a miracle. You know, it's all, sure, it's a miracle of faith, blessing. Oh my God, it's magic. You know, everybody got what they want, but it's just gibberish. You know, and so you can interpret gibberish any which way you want to, right? So of course you could go away with that and say, yeah, we got what we want. Did you get what you want? Sure, everybody did. Let's call it good. And ban anybody that, you know, throws a wrench into it and, you know, tries to clarify it. Now, heresy. Heresy. We can't have clarification. That's heresy. That way somebody's not going to feel happy. You know, didn't get what they wanted. So this has been used from time immemorial of answers. You know, let's just make it gibberish. And we agree that, yeah, I don't know how you got what you want, but and I don't know how you got what you want, but we can, if we both agree we got what we want, we have peace. We say, hey, that's a great idea. We can have peace. Just we disagree. We got what we want. Okay, let's call it good. Let's call it peace. We have peace. Peace in our time. Peace in our time. Ring any bells? You know? Yeah. This is the classic thing of all, you know, treaties among people who disagree and stuff. Yeah. We both got what we wanted. You know, but. But nobody's really quite sure, you know, what the heck that really is the treaty. It's all confusing and everything, but it saves face. Everybody saves face, you know, if it's gibberish. Everyone saves face. Because, of course, they don't know the truth. They didn't know, nobody knew the truth there. But they had to save face. So, you know, they just had to craft something that let everybody save face, and that's what it was. So we've been trying to save face all this time instead of actually hearing the truth. And Jesus came back and said, look, folks, let me tell you, come on, let me reiterate the truth for you, you know, and you got to get with it now, come on, you can do better than what you've done. And I just said, yeah, absolutely, let's do better, let's take up the challenge, you know, not satisfied with confusion. And so it's been quite a challenge, because this whole thing about gibberish and everybody saving face and thinking everybody got what they want, you just, you know, it's hard to... how do you deal with that? It's nonsense. As long as you're trying to figure it out intellectually and academically, you can't do it. You just have to blow the whistle on the whole thing. You just have to apocalypse it. And of course, then people say, well, who are you to apocalypse it? You know, who are you? Who do you think you are? Well, who does anyone think they are to confound the situation? You know, that's the question. It's not who am I to clarify, it's who is anyone to confound it? That's the real question, right? Who are you, ego, to confound the whole situation? It's clear as a bell. We're just pretending to be dead. We pretend that there's some judge, guilt, judging our death, and once it says, yes, you indeed, you died, that somehow we'll resurrect and be greater than God and have a new creation, we'll be prime creator, and everything will be solved. You know, so this is very simple. It's very simple. Who is the ego to confound this simplicity? Who is the ego to confound the simplicity? It's not asking who am I to just state the simple truth. It's who is the ego to compound the simplicity. So I just was someone, I'm tired of suffering from the egoic insanity, you know, arrogance. You say the ego's so arrogant, says, no, I can always compound I can always make it confusing. And I said, well, yeah, but I know, but I'm tired of that, you know. I know the ego can just confuse it forever, but not interested in that anymore, that's all, you know. it's really not such great entertainment. I'm tired of that entertainment, you know. That's enough. That's all. Tired of suffering, tired of misery. Tired of the burnout, tired of the anxiety, tired of the confusion, tired of the pressure, tired of all this kind of stuff. So, yeah, again, I decided to drop the arrogance. Okay, it's simple. There's nothing that's easy to figure out. No big deal, right? Of course, we admire people, diplomats, who are able to craft these compromises that let everyone save face, and we think we solved the problem, but this just compounds the problem, right? Compounds it, and we've just been spinning our wheels for so long. Just like the monks on that island, I often tell that story that they, you know, they're walking on, they're doing all these miracles, and the bishop goes out there to say, oh my gosh, you know, I just got to find out how these monks are doing all these miracles. They're just extraordinary. Bishop gets there and talks to them and stuff, and the bishop's horrified to find out they don't understand the Chalcedon Creed or the Nicene Creed, and they don't even know about it. The bishop says, "My God, these people, I got to set them straight. This is horrible." And so the bishop teaches them the creed, Chalcedon Creed, Nicene Creed, and he leaves, and then he hears a shout as he's in the boat rowing back from the island, and he sees the monks are running across the water towards him. Bishop is astonished, and he says, "My gosh, they're walking across the water. What is this?" And the monks get up to the bishop and say, "Bishop, bishop, 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 we got a big problem." And the bishop says, "What?" And they said, "Well, we kind of forgot what you told us, and we're starting to argue among ourselves. Is it this, or is it this, or is it this? And we've got schisms are happening. You know, arguments." Says, "My God, can you set us straight?" You know. And the bishop just says, "Man, just forget about it. Just, you know, well, he's supposed to say that, right? I don't know if the bishop said it, but we can say it. Don't worry about it. Okay, just keep, you know, doing what you're doing. Don't worry about it." But this is like, you know, where we've been at. You know, you're doing miracles. Oh, okay, but do you understand the creed? You don't understand the creed. Oh my gosh, you know, these miracles must be coming from the devil. You know, and where else could they come from? I mean, if you don't understand the gibberish of the ego, well, I mean, we can't have miracles coming from God, really, can we? I mean, we gotta have miracles, joint miracles from the ego and the God. They both, you know, the ego has to be in there too. Come on. And so, you know, this is what we've had. This is what we've had. And, you know, we better start laughing at it now, because there's a lot to laugh about. Otherwise, you know, we'll just get pulled down, you know, and just say, wow. Yeah, but the great thing to realize is Jesus isn't held hostage by this gibberish. Not in the slightest. Never has been. Never has been. We're just holding ourselves hostage, we're just waiting. But basically, we use religion for us, or just a way to keep us waiting until we guilt find the sides that we died. That's really how we've been using it. So we have to come up with some explanation for Jesus that allows us to keep waiting until guilt test says that we've died, and then we think we'll be greater than God when that happens. So we don't want to admit that, you know, we don't want to admit that to Jesus. "Hey, Jesus, we're thanks for coming, but we want to be greater than God, so we have to fit you in this, you know, into this context, you know, and twist and distort, and kind of have the Theotokos in there, you know, with the, and, you know, that's essential." Even though Jesus never said anything about that and never gave any such instructions or hints or anything like that. This is absolute nonsense. Jesus never been bound by any of this madness whatsoever. He knows the story. It's very simple. We're just waiting. We've been waiting. Waiting. We've been using religion to keep us waiting. As if waiting has been sanctified, as if Jesus came here to sanctify our waiting. Thanks, Jesus. Thanks for sanctifying our waiting. Now we feel we can wait a couple more thousand years, you know, and then that should get the job done. And, you know, it is humorous. I try to put it in a humorous vein like this. That's important. It's very important to make it like cartoonish, you know, which it is. Everything we've been doing is very cartoonish, and we need to look at it that way. You know, we've literally been saying, "Gee, thanks, Jesus, thanks for helping us wait until we finally convince guilt that we're dead. You know, if you hadn't have come, we might not have been able to do it, but somehow we figured out how to help use you as motivation to keep waiting. I gotta keep hanging on a little longer. If I hang on a little longer, I'll get to heaven. You know, if I just keep pretending to be dead, it should work, you know. It should work. If the body dies, that should convince guilt that I'm dead, and then I get to go to heaven. You know, I get to go to heaven from that. So yeah, existence is absolutely absurd. It is cartoonish. And just looking at history, you just can't help but realize it is, and never more so than now. In fact, the cartoons now are just absolutely hilarious. In fact, they're so funny that you were afraid to laugh. You said, "Might not stop laughing," you know. I've been turning on the news a couple, several times. I want to see what the heck is Trump doing these days. And I don't, they never, I never see it, you know, so I just say, what the heck. But in turning on these news channels, it's like, I see the, what's going on, the content, and I just can't believe it. I just, it's so surreal. The whole thing is completely surreal. I just like, completely cartoonish. I mean, are you kidding me? And the thing is, you need to repent. When you repent, you don't worry about saving face. You've already admitted to God, hey God, this is all just a joke, you know. I'm trying to pretend to be dead in order to think that I can be greater than you. I admit to it. And I made up guilt doesn't, there's no judge of my death. There's nothing that can judge that I'm dead. And I can't die. So on both accounts, it's completely absurd. And I want to have the continuity problem resolved for me so I can get back to the glory that you created me to experience. And so where's the loss of face there? There's no loss of face. There's no longer worried about loss of face, you know, when you're repented. But these people are still pretending to die. These spirits, fellow spirits, you know, they're like petrified about losing face. I mean, you can hardly say anything these days. If you make anyone lose face, everyone like freaks out, completely freaks out. They haven't repented. It's a very non-repentant culture right now. The tone, the whole tone is wrong right now. This is the problem. The tone that is being set is so absurd. Okay, I just, wow, it can be depressing if you pay too much attention to it. It can get very depressing, actually. It's like, I just entered a cartoon land or something? The inauthenticity of the world now is very depressing, for sure. So you need to find what is authentic and start breathing that air of authenticity. Now, when you're young, what do? You look for musical bands, right, performing. To feel that authenticity, you feel the plasticity of this world. It's all fake. Everybody's trying to save face, and you rebel. Say, wow, you know, I hate this. It's terrible. And you look for bands like who make you feel authentic. Yeah, they're up on the stage, and they're doing this, that, or that, whatever your style, whatever you like, or something. And you know, if they're jumping around and they're hitting those chords and they're making noise and they're screaming, they're yelling and they're having fun and they're acting like, you know, like, hey, we don't care about the world, the plasticity, man. We're just gonna rock on here. Yeah, that's it. And so, or whatever, you know, riff on or sing on or play on or whatever your music style you'd like. But you know what I'm talking about. And we say, well, they're so authentic. And my parents are so plastic. My parents' friends are so plastic. And the culture is so plastic. I can't stand it. I hate it. But this band, oh my God, they're so authentic. You know, they don't care. They just say whatever they want to say. They act the way they want to act. They dress the way they want to dress. You know, of course, we don't realize that they're experts at portraying sort of this ersatz authenticity, knowing that it sells, knowing that it really sells. And it's big business. Selling ersatz authenticity is huge, huge business. Now, of course, I did that. I mean, I got caught up in that too. You're looking for authenticity, but also in the back of my head, I said, well, this is not it. This isn't really, we need something way better than this. I got these problems of this Chalcedon creed, you know, this schisms and why, you know, all this stuff. I said, holy, you know, I was very aware that that Christianity has all these problems, you know, and I wanted to solve the problems. I said, it's time to get free of this stuff. And you can't just shift over to some other religion. You know, that doesn't really work because, you know, this is the history I have in this world, and Judeo-Christian history, Western civilization. I mean, it's part of the very fiber of our experiencing here in this world, and so in order to set it all down, you know, we need to resolve this. You know, we can't just shift over to Buddhism and say, what the heck, you know, let's go, because they have their own. They have problems too, you know, and I'm not an expert. I could be if I wanted, but Christianity is what I'm focusing on. Could turn the same clarity on anything, but I want to, you know, it's focused on Christianity now in resolving this whole situation. But the situation is exactly the same for everyone. This is all a pretense. We're pretending to die. Doesn't matter how you label it, what kind of, academic set of labels you apply, whether it's this religion's labels or that religion's labels, whatever, it's all the same. Ultimately, we're pretending to die, believing that guilt can judge that we've died, and then we'll be greater than God. And this is the insanity we've been in, whimsical adventure that we've been engaged in. So it's worth repeating again that spirit wanted to be greater than God. So I want to try and be the prime creator. So I have to be prior to God. So my will has to be greater than God's. I have to change the will of God. But the will of God is one. It's seamless. So if I change the will of God, everything is basically gone. And it means I'd be gone too. Spirit says I'd be gone too. So in order to be greater than God, I have to be annihilated. But Spirit said, well, how the heck am I going to know then? How can I experience being greater than God if I'm annihilated, right? So Spirit said, hey, I got an idea. Why don't I just fake being annihilated? Pretend to be annihilated and convince guilt, this judge that I've died. And then when I convince guilt that I've died, then I guess, then it will be true that I've died. And yet I will just be pretending that I died. And then somehow by convincing guilt, then I will be able to be alive again. It's just a crazy scheme we dreamed up. That's it. Just a crazy scheme. And so we don't need to worry about Christology. We don't need to worry about Christology at all. They say the creed every mass, as the Apostolic Creed is one of those, the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, this and this and that. I can't tell it to you verbatim. But you confess. It's a confession of a creed. This is the all important thing. This is what, now back then, what they wanted to differentiate: did you belong to the church or not? Are you one of us or not? And so you needed to confess this creed to convince them that you were part of that, the church. And if you refuse to say this creed, then they said you're an outsider. You're not part of the church. This is another sort of bonding, sort of community, sort of situation. So I don't know if I pull up the Nicene Creed or not. It doesn't seem to be responding here. That's okay. Or maybe it is now. N-I-C-E-N-E, Nicene Creed. Well, let's search for it or not. Nicene Creed. Search. Yeah, there you go. And you think that, by saying this, that I'm part of the family of Christ, body of Christ, because I'm confessing this creed. And this creed is something that they hashed out politically, trying to satisfy everybody, knowing, but not able to completely satisfy everybody, but having to satisfy Theotokos, idea of Mother of God, that's got to be in there. And anyone who doesn't put that in there, well, that's anathema. That heresy. Banish them. Nicene Creed. Let me see if it gives us that. The original creed. Oh, there you go. We believe in one God. This is the first Council of Nicaea, then the first Council of Constantinople. Okay. This is in, they tweaked it a little bit. In Constantinople, the first council says, here it goes. We believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all worlds, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary and was made man. He was crucified for us under Pontius Pilate and suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. From thence he shall come again with glory to judge the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And in the Holy Ghost, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spake by the prophets. In one holy Catholic and apostolic church, we acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Okay, so this kind of skirts, you know, some of the issues. But that's the Nicene Creed. That is what you hear when you go to Catholic Church. That's what you say every day, every Mass. Okay. But, you know, that's like, compared to the Chalcedon Creed, that's like very somewhat clear, you know, in that it doesn't engage in massive gibberish. It doesn't really say much, though, either, does it? I mean, no. It just throws some words around there. Keep in mind that Hellenized culture was, you know, Greek philosophy had all sorts of ideas about the soul, and a lot of these words. A lot of Christianity is Greek, came from Greek philosophy, a lot of it. And some from rabbinical culture of the Jews. It was a sort of combination of the Greeks and the Jews and the Romans. You know, it was sort of a mishmash of all that kind of stuff. They said, how do we try to, you know, please everybody and still get it right? You know, well, you know what? You can't please the ego and still get it right. Okay? Because the ego is all about getting it wrong. And the ego says, you're right when you get it perfectly wrong. But how can we actually get it perfectly wrong? Because we still are perfect in God's mind. So how can we actually get it perfectly wrong? Remember, the ego tells us we should be able to get it perfectly wrong. And once we get it perfectly wrong, then magically we'll, you know, be all right. So agree with the ego. Yeah, I already am perfectly stupid. But the perfection, you see, is what's important. So we can't get it perfectly wrong. We can only say, I am perfect. So whatever the, you know, you can agree with the ego, it's a great practice. Yeah, I am perfect, the perfect idiot. I'm the perfect idiot. And you acknowledge your perfection, right? You acknowledge your perfection. And then you automatically dawns upon you, hey, this idiocy is only pretense. Yeah, I am perfectly stupid. Absolutely, I'm perfectly stupid. So you're already there. See, the ego wants you to attain perfect stupidity. You say, no, ego, I am already perfectly stupid. Takes the wind out of the ego's sails, and that's all we need to do. All we need to do is to suck all the oxygen out of the tent, ego's tent. Okay, take all the wind out of its sails. Once we take the wind out of the ego's sails, the truth will just dawn upon us automatically. We don't have to force. Jesus said, all we're doing is removing the blocks to love's presence, the presence of love, the presence, which is ultimately said the presence of freedom, our freedom. And of course, we have this intermediate step where we're pretending to be eternal life before we finally drop all pretense. But all we have to do is remove the blocks. We're not doing anything other than that. So it's very important to take the wind out of the ego's sails. So just agree with your adversary, as Jesus said, agree with your adversary quickly. Just say, yeah. Whatever the ego, yeah, I am perfectly insane. Yes, I'm already perfectly insane. Yes, I'm already perfectly terrible. Yes, I'm already perfectly idiotic. Yes, I'm already perfectly arrogant. Yes, I'm already perfectly egoic. Yes, I'm already perfectly stupid. Whatever the ego says, there's a great practice. Takes the air out of the sails of the ego. And then automatically you feel, you know, way, way less frightened of reality by that. So we do have these tools that work, because I've used them on myself. And they work. But they don't work too fast. I mean, it's not like I've been thrown, catapulted into, you know, into something, into perfection. No, but I'm breathing the air of authenticity more and more and more and more and more. It's easier and easier and easier and easier to say this kind of stuff, which, you know, before, you know, I couldn't say it, really. It's too tough. It's too tough. And, you know, almost nobody's saying anything like this. It's very difficult because you have to be relaxed with your authenticity in some way, at a deep level, to be able to talk like this. People might be able to think like this, you know, a little bit, but to talk like it, you know, you really have to breathe the air of authenticity so you can actually say it. And a lot of times my voice will try to seize up and start coughing and, you know, like block me from doing this. So it's quite difficult to actually express this in the world, because the whole world's whole goal is to be completely inauthentic, to become perfectly dead to what we are, perfectly dead. But we can't be perfect. We can't become perfectly dead. Right? We're already perfect. This is what we need to remind ourselves. We can say, "Well, I'm already a perfect pretender. I'm already a perfect pretender. See, I'm already a perfect pretender." This reminds us of our inherent perfection. And then that's what's important. We're taking the wind out of the sails of the ego by doing that. We're removing the blocks to the presence of love, to our awareness. How are we doing here? Great. Moving right along. So we can have a lot of fun with all the talk of Christology and the words that they use and the words that they talk about, you know, the heresy. So, well, that's, you know, we can't have that heresy. And there's another one. And they labeled every heresy with some special Greek term, and which is very funny. Yeah. All the various schisms and stuff. Yeah, so it's funny stuff. And it's good to be able to look back and you know, on the Trail of Tears, and be able to have a laugh at it, you know, that is for sure. Controversies, yeah, lots of different controversies. Just looking at this is. Monophysitism. Only one nature. Council of Ephesus debated hypostasis, coexisting natures, versus monophysitism, only one nature, versus miaphysitism, two natures united as one, versus Nestorianism, disunion of two natures. Of course, Nestorians might disagree with that. So from the Christological viewpoint, the council adopted hypostasis, i.e. coexisting natures, but its language was less definitive than the 451 Council of Chalcedon. The Oriental Orthodox rejected this in subsequent councils and to date consider themselves to be miaphysite. By contrast, Roman Catholics to date and most Protestants believe in the hypostatic union and the Trinity. The council also confirmed the Theotokos title and excommunicated Nestorius. Oh, okay. Great. Great. That's a nice little Roadrunner cartoon right there, right? It was a nice little episode. Nah, we're just trying to pretend to be dead and then convince guilt that we're dead. That's all we're doing. You know, we don't need this song and dance anymore. You know, we can confess the truth. You know, I have one confession to make sure. I've been pretending to try to be dead and trying to convince the non-existent guilt, this non-existent judge of my death, that I am dead, which would then grant me the authority to be greater than God. That's all I've been doing. That's it. Where's the council on that? We don't even need to call a council at Constantinople or Antioch or Alexandria, Ephesus, or wherever, Jerusalem. What do we need to call a council for? I just confess to God. You repent. Hey God, this is what I tried to do. I tried to be greater than you, God. I made up this imaginary principle called guilt, which is supposed to be able to judge my death, and then I thought that when I convinced guilt that I had died, then this would enable me then to be greater than you. You see, but there is no death. I can't die. This is all just a completely childish scheme that we, you know, have a good laugh about it, and then that's about it. I mean, that's all you can do is have a, you know, have a good laugh at it, because it really, there's nothing more to it than that. But we're very, of course, our imagination, our creativity is love, you know, loves to play, you know, so we've concocted all of this stuff, you know, this dream, this very intricate dream, to try and convince guilt that we indeed died to what we are. We're no longer spirit, we're not flesh. But then how does divinity come in the world? Well, we've got to figure that one out, you know. And of course, they couldn't really ever figure it out. It was some gibberish. Please, you know, so the principal power brokers could both go with and save face and say, okay. But the schisms went on, you know, and the debates went on, and the anger went on, and it continued on and on and on and on. Well, if you just recognize I've died, then I'll be safe, because guilt will then believe I've died. But it doesn't work. Guilt still hasn't recognized my death. Well, maybe you're not, just because you're not recognizing my death, that's why guilt hasn't recognized my death. So you're to blame for that. The other person says, no, wait a minute, it's the opposite way. You're to blame for the fact that guilt hasn't recognized my death yet. So we're all hating on each other, saying, you're the reason why guilt hasn't recognized my death yet, because you're somehow taking me to not be truly dead. So, it's your fault. So you project this impossibility outwardly, thinking that at least I have a hope because I can change their behavior, which is this technocratic culture is wanting to control everybody's behavior so we can convince guilt that we truly are dead. Everybody's acting very dead right now in the world. Even the Grateful Dead are now dead. We've gone that far. The dead finally said, it's time for us to truly die. Yeah. So now we're dead too. So that should bring on the new millennia, right? Where guilt will say, congratulations, everybody. You congratulations, you now are truly dead, and welcome to the new creation. Welcome to the millennium. No. It really is beyond that funny. It really is beyond that theatrical. Look at it like this absurd farce that's being put on. Because that's what it is. It's what it is. We just imagine there's some judge, you know. God the judge is judging us. That's our guilt. You know, what most people think of as God is really guilt. This imaginary guilt, this imaginary principle is supposed to be judging us. Judges our death, supposed to judge our death. And we're waiting for it to finally say, okay, you've truly died. Congratulations, now welcome to heaven. You know, like that. There is no such judge. You know, we can't get past God as judge thing. We're trying to, but we're just like having this trouble. And they're struggling with that. Christianity struggle with that. How do we, we gotta be judged, don't we? I mean, there's this judging principle. What do we do with that? We got to please that principle. So no, we made up that judging principle. There isn't any judge. God, there's no judgment in God whatsoever. There's no judging principle at all. Except the Holy Spirit can say, well, final judgment is that there is no judging principle, if you want to call that a judgment. That sort of cancels out the whole notion of judgment, doesn't it? So it's the illusion that dispels all other illusions, and then therefore is not necessary anymore. So there is no judge. There is no judge. And we're frantically, we say, we've got to have a judge. I mean, how else are we going to convince ourselves that we died? Because if we truly die, we won't know it. So there's got to be something other than us or God, you see. It can't be God, because God, if we die, means God's also dead. So there has to be something separate from God that can judge that we truly died. And then that judge will say, okay, congratulations, in proving that you truly died, now I have the authority to resurrect you from that death and into a new life where you are now the prime creator. You see, we invented this separate entity, this idea of a separate judge entity with this capacity. We just arrogated this capacity that it has the power to raise us from the dead, spiritual death. But first we have to spiritually die, And then this activates the power. Once we've died, then this power will use its power on us to resurrect us from the spiritual death and into eternal life as prime creator, new prime creator. Wow, you know, yeah, wow. So we're putting all this stuff in the rear view mirror is what we're doing. All this Christology in the rear view mirror. The Chalcedonian Creed did not put an end to all Christological debate. Oh, really? Wonder why. It did clarify the terms used and became a point of reference for many future Christologies. Most of the major brands of Christianity, Roman Catholicism, Eastern Orthodoxy, Anglicanism, Lutheranism, and Reformed ascribed to the Chalcedonian Christological formulation, while many branches of Eastern Christianity, Syrian Orthodoxy, Assyrian Church, Coptic Orthodoxy, Ethiopian Orthodoxy, and Armenian Apostolicism rejected. There you go. The person of Christ refers to the study of the human and divine natures of Jesus Christ as they coexist within one person. Huh? That's like saying death and life coexist within one person. But how do we reconcile that? We don't, because it's not true. Spirit is pretending to be dead. There's not any real death. There's not any real person at all. It's just a dream. It's a pretense. There's no coexistent problem at all. There's nothing to solve. There's nothing to figure out. And that, in that way, you know, two different natures, how they're coexisting in one person. No, there's none of that. None of it whatsoever. So the question doesn't even arise. When you get it right, the question doesn't arise. It's a pseudo question. All this Christology is a pseudo problem. It's a pseudo problem, which is really stating a basic premise within the questions that it asks, right? That's called a pseudo question, pseudo problem. It's saying, well, there are two natures, so how do we deal with this? No, they're not two natures. There's only one nature, which is divinity, which is perfection, and it's just pretending to be dead. It's trying to be greater than God. So there isn't any question about how do we deal with these two natures at all. That's a pseudo problem, pseudo question. You don't have to answer pseudo problems or pseudo questions at all. You just have to reject the premise and turn to the true premise. That's all. So maybe this is a dream I had, you know, that someone from Antioch's coming and wants me to lead off and be the lead. Maybe this is it. You know, the church age is over. I officially declare the church age over. All Christology is officially over. You know, it was a pseudo problem all along. Okay, now we know the truth, that we've simply, you know, made up this judge. It doesn't exist in reality whatsoever. It's just a fantasy. So that could then allow us to indulge in this fantasy that we can be greater than God. So we think that we're able to prove our death to this fantasy judge, and then when we do that, this fantasy judge has the power to resurrect us from our spiritual death, where we can then live in the glory of being the new prime creator. This is all just a fantasy. It's just a capricious fantasy is all it is. There's no Christology to apply to it really whatsoever. All right? Jesus basically just came to tell us this, that's all. There's no Christology to it. That's how you dispel a pseudo problem, is you don't answer it according to the demands of the demands of the premise at all. You reject the premise. Say, no, the premise isn't correct. And people say, well, again, we'll say, well, who the heck do you think you are? You know, to say, declare an end of the church age and all those. I say, well, you know, who is anyone to be arrogant to insist that they cannot do this? You know, that's the question. Who is it that insists they can't do this? Where does that come from? So welcome to the apocalypse. You know, you're experiencing it right here, right now. It's like, hey, this is fun. You know, I think I'll get some more popcorn. Absolutely get some more popcorn. And we say, wait a minute. I'm so used to thinking, trying to figure out this answer to a false question. And now I get the answer, and I don't have to think so much anymore, do I? So what the heck? You know, well, yeah, okay. Just get some popcorn. Lemonade. Today I got some both. I got lemonade, mango lemonade, cherry limeade. And cherry lemonade. And what else? Maybe just some straight lemonade. So I got lots of lemonade and popcorn. What else do you need in July anyway? As we, you know, as we enjoy the apocalypse. Enjoy the apocalypse. Enjoy the game. Enjoy the apocalypse. Don't get all caught up in trying to figure it out. Just enjoy it. Say, this is fun. You know, have a good laugh about it. Have a good laugh. Don't get caught up in it. Just experience it. You know, just a wow. Wow. I'm just hanging out. This is better than drugs, you know. Way better. Hey, if you're on drugs, you're going to miss the apocalypse. I'm telling you that. Get off the drugs, you know, as much as possible, including caffeine, guarana, and was it yerba mate or whatever. I mean, just get off all the stimulants. Get off all the drugs as much as possible, you know. Just do the best you can, right? Because if you're on drugs, you're going to miss the apocalypse. Because you'll be having this false apocalypse, like, all right, I'm on these drugs. Wow, I mean, like I'm having this fake apocalypse. This is really weird, you know. But you know, you're missing the real intensity, the greatness of it. Absolutely, you know. Hey, someone just declared the church age is over, rendered it null and void, and it's finished. Excommunicated the Pope, you know, set aside Christology once and for all. All the schisms, all the debates are now null and void. There was no substance to them in the first place, you know, stated the truth of the whole situation. You know, wow, this is very cool. This is quite apocalyptic, isn't it? And, you know, there's lots of facets to the apocalypse. I think this is a very compelling one for sure. And there's other stuff going on where, again, people are dropping any pretense as far as their position is concerned. Their position is now becoming crystal clear. And we're saying, uh-oh. It's kind of like it's a masquerade, and the masquerade ball, and everyone's taking, you know, the mask is coming off everybody. And you say, oh my gosh, that's who you are, you know. Yeah, you know, that's not the part of the masquerade ball. I think that everyone wears these masks, and at the end, they take the masks off, which is like a mind blower, you know. So this is fun. This is fun. Don't be afraid of the apocalypse. Enjoy it. Get your chips. I even got a dip today. But it's a funny thing. It's too fattening, the dips. So I got this spinach dip, which I thought would be great. But it was horrible. I'm not going to even eat it. It's so terrible. So first time in my life, I've got a bad dip. Usually all dips are good, but not this one. Which saved me from gaining a couple pounds, that's for sure. So yeah, a lot of times I just eat popcorn right now. It's a popcorn time in the world. See if you can't get something like that, a comfort food, you know. Just say, because it, you know, see, the real show is the apocalypse. Don't get caught up in the other nonsense. If you do, you'll miss the apocalypse. So have this larger perspective. When you're watching a show or the news or something, instead of, you know, getting into the topics, just let the realization say, hey, wait a minute. These people are like completely plastic. They're completely inauthentic. It's all faked authenticity. Wow. And they're not even, it's become obvious now. You know, holy cow, that's the apocalypse. You suddenly are experiencing the apocalypse. It's all, you know, surreal. It's all fake. It's all plastic. It's all inauthentic. And the masks are coming off. And just, holy cow. You know, the villains, they're really the villains. I mean, they're so villainous. It's like, you know, holy cow. You know, this is like the arch villain of all arch villains, you know, and they're villainesses. And it's okay. Nice to meet you. It's all okay. This is all just complete pretend anyway. Nothing to figure out. Nothing to get. You know, just, you know, be honest with God. That's all. Honest with yourself. Who had the authority to call those councils anyway? Well, you know, the emperor, Roman emperor. The bishops would be demanding, writing letters to the emperor. We got this big schism going on, big controversy. You know, I want to. Theotokos is all important. Some Nestor is saying, no, it's not. And we can't let this stand. This is causing great conflict. And they're rioting in my city. You know, there's so much trouble. Please call a council. We got to get this ironed out. So the emperor would say, okay, boys, come on. And let's get together in Ephesus and, you know, hash this out. And so they'd all show up there in Ephesus and you know, try to, you know, just like, it's like, you know, politics, you know, you didn't show up on time, you don't get to vote, you know, or all these procedural maneuvers they used, you know, it's just ridiculous. I mean, it's just, you look at the you know, politics today, it's all being, the whole thing, we're seeing it clearly. Oh my gosh, these people are just liars, they're deceivers, you know, and they're not apologetic about it at all. They say, well, that's the way we do things, you know. Same thing back then, you know. Just this, all this maneuvering and politicking and making alliances and trying to block this person. You vote for me, I'll do you a favor down the line. You push my agenda through, I'll support you, you know, being powerful and blah, blah, blah. So that's how it was. What can you even say about that? You know, they cobbled something together, you know, but what is it? What is it really? I mean, did they get to the truth of anything? To the situation? Did they get to the truth of the situation? Not at all. Are they getting the truth of situations now? No, not at all. People are running around saying, well, I don't really know what I'm voting on. I'm going to vote for it, but I don't even know what I'm voting for. But, you know, I said I'd vote for it. Someone promised me, you know, if I voted for it, I'd get something out of that this way. So, yeah, I'm going to vote for it. I just don't know what it is. Oh, that's okay. You know, that's just how we do business here. Yeah. And someone says, hey, wait a minute. You know, that's not right. That's not, you're cheating the people. You're cheating. How dare you speak up? You know, it's like, it's the end of the Wizard of Oz. You know, the curtain's being raised on Oz. You know, the Wizard of Oz, the wizard. Sing. And so we're just like, you know, just don't miss the apocalypse. You know, enjoy it. You know, maybe Jesus is just back to help us enjoy the apocalypse. He's not back to say too much of anything, and just to hang out. He says, oh, this is funny. And just, you know, just to kind of hang out like a friend, and like a friend going to a movie, just in the movie is the apocalypse. We're just enjoying it here. And, you know, cracking jokes, you know. I'm sure Jesus has a great sense of humor from what I've experienced. He's someone like you can joke with. I met someone a while back that fabulous sense of humor, good reef. They moved, their position changed, so I don't see him anymore. But whatever you said to him, he would say something back in a way which would make us all laugh, and the whole situation would become like witty, you know, wonderfully witty and funny. It's amazing. Love people like that. And so Jesus is like that, you know, really. I say, what are you guys worrying about? You know, you crack a joke about Chalcedon Council or something, and, you know, and make a play on the gibberish, you know. You mean you don't know what emophyticism is or whatever, you know. Shame on you. That's the key to it all, isn't it? The fittacisms. You got to have the hypostatic union in there. I mean, if you don't have that, you don't have anything. You know, I'm all about the hypostatic union. Are you kidding me? Hey, Jesus, you know, what are you about? Well, it's the hypostatic union, of course. What do you think? Isn't that what they decided back then? The council? Oh, yeah. I forgot about that. Shame. He said, well, that's okay. Yeah, it's an inside joke, inside humor, inside spiritual humor, you know. My gosh. What am I with? Maybe Jesus has come back. And I said, Jesus, why are you back? He said, well, I forgot about the hypostatic union. I've got to come back. Can you explain it to me? You know, I said, oh, of course, Jesus, sit down. I'll explain it to you. It's all a joke. You know, this is really spiritual humor. You know, something like that. You know, Jesus could be like that, actually. Hey, Jesus, you know, everyone said, why are you back, Jesus? My gosh, you've come back. What do you have to say to us? He said, Jesus, you know, I was in glory and reality, everything, and then I said, kind of forgotten what the hypostatic union was really meant. And I started getting all nervous. I said, oh, my gosh, maybe I got to come back here, and I can have someone explain it to me. Let's hold another council and get this figured out. I'm not quite sure, you know, what it's all about. there's a joke. Of course, he's joking. But if you take it serious, you know, you think, uh-oh, you know, something wrong in reality or something. But if you understand what he's saying, it's hilarious. Absolutely hilarious. And this breaks the ice. You know, you think Jesus here, say, oh my gosh, you know, so now what was the creed? Was it an Nicene Creed, Chalcedonian Council? What do I confess now? I gotta make sure that he understands that I understand the hypostatic union of two natures and what that all really means. It's two natures, separate and distinct natures, and yet they're not two natures separate and distinct, and yet they're one. But they're not originally one, and but they're not a union either, and it's just all mysterious Yeah, that's the explanation. How do I explain that, though, that Jesus is, it's all mysterious, you know, so he's very mysterious to me. Why you're so mysterious, Jesus? I can't remember why you're so mysterious. I'm supposed to remember you're mysterious, huh? You know. That's why in the dream I'm walking by, I have this dream of Jesus is there, and everybody's walking by, I just walk right past him. I said, what the heck's going on? And because they're all trying to figure out why. It's very mysterious. There's a very mysterious figure there. And I said, what the heck? I just come up and say, how you doing? And sit down, start talking. He's like, no mystery at all, you know? It's like, okay. Now, but people just pass them by. They're thinking, holy cow, I forgot the creed. You know, I say it every day at Mass. You know, the priest will say, okay, do you remember the creed? Let me see. Let me put it up there on the board. You know, okay, I said the creed. Everything's okay now. I'm able to accept communion now because I said the creed, you know, that's agreed upon by the politicians, agreed upon 1,500 years ago or more. So, yeah, have some fun, have some humor, lighten up the situation, you see. If you start recognizing this humor, you might even be able to crack a joke with Jesus, you see. It's, yeah, the hypostatic union is the perfect place to start. Start and end, the alpha and the omega of the hypostatic union. Explains everything, doesn't it? Absolutely. It's a mystery. Just have the faith in the hypostatic union. Yeah, and then kind of say, well, I kind of hopefully get it. I don't really get it, but it's coming. I hope it's coming. So we've all been going to go to church and trying to believe in the hypostatic union. That's the answer. Somebody had it figured out. You know, we all have faith that somebody figured it out. But those folks, you know, who did this, they say, well, I hope somebody in the future figures it out because we sure don't get it. And we say, I hope somebody figured it out in the past because we sure don't get it. You know, so the past and the future are both hoping that the other one has got it, you know, because they sure don't have it. And we're all saving faces. It's like helping time save face, you know, got to save the face of time. So, maybe the hypostatic union can save face, the face of time for us. It's a Greek word, of course. Yeah. A lot of Greek words, a lot of, you know, they like to speculate on all this stuff. No, and it's not the new hypostatic union is the European Union, I guess. Everyone's trying to figure that one out. They think they have it figured out. And the Greeks are saying, "Well, now we this like this." And the Germans say, "No, it's like this." So we still have this. We just need to introduce maybe the hypostatic union instead of the European Union. Folks, just go for the hypostatic union. Diversity as one, different natures, not joined, not united, not adopted, not born that way either, but born still, the oneness is born and the other is there. Oh, this is Comedy Central. The people who do comedy, I mean, hopefully you've seen through it. I mean, these people are absolute, militants for pharmaceutical culture and antichrist belief. And I mean, they're not even remotely funny. I mean, they're just complete, automaton puppets for, for the PC pharmaceutical culture and CCC cosmic corporate culture and the pretending to be deadness of it all, I mean, the comedy is so dead, it's unbelievable. I mean, where's their sense of humor? Can they sit down with Jesus and have a good laugh? I don't think so, right? I mean, it's so stilted. I mean, it's a funny thing is like I don't watch comedy anymore. It's I can't. But actually, you can get high comedy by watching the comedians, because it's so ridiculously unfunny that it's funny. It's hilariously ridiculous. It's so ridiculously not funny at all. And yet everybody's pretending that it's funny, That's hilarious. We can see that level of humor. I mean, the audience is lapping it up like someone said something funny. Like, "Hey, we're all dead." "Oh my gosh, that's funny. Yeah, we're all dead here." And we thought we were alive, but actually we're dead. And, "Oh yeah, that's right. That's hilarious. How could we think that we're alive? That is really funny." "Yeah, some idiot over there. You know what? They started feeling a little bit authentic, but we crushed them." "Oh God, that's funny. Yeah. That's so hilariously funny. We crushed the authenticity there." Yes. And it's like, wow, I mean, this is the comedy I enjoy. This is like stand-up comedy right here. For me, it's like doing stand-up comedy. But very few get it. Very few get it, because we're so used to this other stuff, which is like the comedy of being dead. "This is what it's like to be dead. I think being dead's really funny. Don't you think it's really funny? I think it's hilarious being dead. Yeah. In fact, I'm going to keep on laughing until I die. But I'm still not completely dead. It doesn't guilt us, still hasn't judged. So we gotta wait for the final judgment. We gotta wait for the judgment. Well, we gotta have a limbo then, or what is it? You gotta wait for it. We'll die, but we gotta wait for it there. And then once the final judgment happens, then we'll finally get to go to heaven. But we just gotta make sure that we're." Make sure that we've truly died, so we're trying here our best here. "Can you tell me a joke that'll make a joke out of authenticity so I can feel more dead?" Sure. We got lots of jokes like that, I mean, the humor in the world is truly a joke in itself. The biggest joke there is, and of course they're really deadly serious about being dead. But they try to put it in a joking format, "Hey everybody, how's it feel? How does it feel to be dead? Tonight, everybody out there, how you feeling? You all feel dead?" And everyone goes, "Yeah, we feel really dead, tonight." "Great, great, great. We're gonna help you make sure that you stay feeling really dead tonight. So, yeah." "Oh yeah, thank you very much. That's wonderful." I mean, there's some that I just like, oh my God, this is really, it's hard to laugh, but if you can, I don't want to name names, I don't want to put anyone on the spot, but you can probably figure it out. I mean, there are some they have their little comedy shows on TV or their little talk shows, discussion shows, whatever. It's just like, wow. I mean, they lay it on so strong. It's just hilarious if you see the plasticity of it. It's like, so man, you mean you actually are thinking like maybe you can be authentic? Wow, really? They play the audience, and they go, "Yeah, we got a loony here," And the audience is, "Ah, we know you're gonna chop them up into bits." Says, "Yeah, I'm gonna let them, give them plenty of rope so they hang themselves, And don't worry, I'll get them in the end, Don't worry, don't worry." And so, you experienced some authenticity. Did you believe in God? Huh? You'd really? He goes, "Yeah, how'd that happen?" He said, "Well, you know that you're actually suffering from mental illness, don't you?" No, I'm authentic. I'm really authentic." "Oh, okay, God, just smug, condescending. Just, you really think that you might not be dead? Oh, that's really funny. My God, let's all have a great laugh at that. Thanks for sharing that, making us all laugh. We just invited you here so we could laugh at you, actually. I mean, you actually think that there might be, that you might not be dead? Holy cow, everybody, let's have a great laugh at this fool." That's really pretty much what they use their programs for. Let's all laugh together at this fool who thinks they might be possibly authentic. Maybe they saw a trace of it, or at least some fleeting fragment. Maybe they had a dream. Like, "I tell you, I dreamed I was might be authentic, might not be dead." "Oh, great! You believe in the tooth fairy too? Let's go. Well, come on in. Come on down. Let's have some fun with you. We'll, punch you around a little bit and then kick you off the stage." And it's got like some sort of like, mockery. They love the mockery and stuff of authenticity, So we're giving a little comedy back, and we're enjoying our comedy actually. Sense of humor. "So what the matter? You don't have a sense of humor?" They'll say. Of course, everything that they do, they say, "Well, it's all just a joke. It's just a sense. You don't have a sense of humor. What's the matter with you? Yeah, comedy. Come on, you don't get it." Well, of course, we're saying this is comedy too. What's the matter? You don't get it? You don't have a sense of humor? You need to develop a sense of humor. It's acquired taste, of course, and you need to be like really smart. You see, if you don't blame me, you don't get the humor. It's your own lack of smartness. You gotta up your smarts. Absolutely. Hot day today, 102. Tomorrow's supposed to be hotter. It wasn't bad at all. It's just dry heat and very nice day. This wasn't really bothersome. No humidity at all. But it's a nice evening, completely still air. Crickets are just going full blast, or the chirpy chirper 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 chirpers, cicadas, whatever it is that make a chorus of, and nice and warm, balmy, beautiful. So developing a healthy sense of humor is very helpful for how you feel. Glass half full. When you can realize, hey, I can joke. Just think that you can actually joke with Jesus. How about that? How about that? When I come face to face with Jesus, I'd be more interested in joking with Jesus than trying to, convince him of how smart I am or whatever, Because joking with Jesus is showing you how smart you are actually, because this is all a joke. We just forgot to laugh at it, is what he says. This is all, as he said, we just simply forgot to laugh at it. And once we learn to laugh at it, that'll be the end of it. So, in the instances I have visited with Jesus, especially recently, it's just been casual conversation and kind of joking, a little laughing, a little joking, lightheartedness, and that's it. I'm not trying to say, "Hey, Jesus, can you explain the hypostatic union to me?" And he probably would say, "No, I can't. No, I can't. That's the one thing I can't do. I can do everything, but I can't do that." So finally found something. I finally found the limits of my intelligence. I can't explain how the impossible is possible. Yeah, too much. The spider is hanging out again, just like pretty cool to be a spider right now, just hanging in the air, just suspended in the air, like floating in the air in this beautiful evening of stillness and calm and balminess, and the spider's just like hanging there in the air, just floating on the breeze like that. Pretty cool. Saying like, I'm spirit, I'm free. Or maybe the spider is like trying to figure out the hypostatic union, maybe thinks I have the answer here, so it's like hanging out here, says, do you have the answer? I said, no, ask Jesus, you know. So what happens? A guy, you know, some guy, you know, meets Jesus and says, hey, Jesus, you know, nice to meet you, but all the folks back in the world, you know, all these people, they're desperate for the answer. You know, can you tell me the answer? And Jesus says, well, what's the question? So what's the hypostatic union, Jesus? You got to tell me that I can tell the folks back, and then they'll finally, you know, solve the problem. And Jesus says, I don't know. I can't help you with that. What? What am I going to say to everybody? When I said I met Jesus and I come back without the answer, are you kidding me? They'll be so disappointed. They'll think I'm an idiot. And Jesus says, well, you just tell them that you're a perfect idiot. You just tell them you met a perfect idiot. I can't tell you Jesus is a perfect idiot because they'll get upset because they're waiting for you to tell them the answer about, you know, what the hypostatic union is. Explain it to them. He says, oh, well, uh-oh, you got a problem. Yeah, I got a problem. So, yeah, everybody expects you to meet Jesus. You got to come away with the answer. Well, I can tell them, well, Jesus didn't understand the question. How dare you? Of course, Jesus will understand the question. No, I mean, you meet Jesus, what do? You have a lot of good laugh, that's all. Maybe Jesus has been waiting for someone to joke with him for a long time. maybe he stayed away from this world. He says, man, I gotta get away from this place, man. They're obsessed with Christology, you know, just driving me nuts. You know, I would get away from this place, and maybe I'll come back in a couple thousand years. Maybe there'll be some people, that will be able to at least hang out with me and be friends and joke. I mean, come on, this is too much. I gotta. So he comes back. Does anybody, you know, want to relate with me just as a friend? I mean, I don't want to hear this Christology stuff. I don't want questions about Christology. Are you kidding me? This is all completely irrelevant questions, actually. You know, because everybody said, oh, Jesus, I got to ask him, you know, got to find the truth. Got to ask him these questions. And Jesus explains, well, this is just trying to pretend to be dead and pretend that there's this judge that can judge me dead and then we'll resurrect from the, you know, that's it. He said, okay, what else do we talk about now if that's it? And, well, joke around. Joke around, you know, wow. See, so we've got all these questions for Jesus, you know, questions. He doesn't want to, you know, spend his time answering these questions. It's all based on false premise, you know. Where does that get us? You know, where does addressing questions based on a false premise get us at all? You know, you just have to not answer the questions. Don't ask them even. How are we doing? Oh, pretty good. Just going towards midnight here. Awesome. I had to go big today. I still got to go big, you know, so you think maybe the day's over? No, it's not. I still have to upload stuff, graphics, I said, to Twitter, blog, Facebook, you know, and get this rendering, this video rendering, so be up till 1 o'clock in the morning at least doing that. That's what I do. Sometimes 2 o'clock in the morning. I used to go 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning. But that was when I was younger. Wasn't working. And I couldn't sleep anyway. So I just, you know, that's the life of somebody who's trying to get free of the hypostatic union problem. Trying to get a little humor, you know, trying to develop a little humor. That's the life of, you know, humor is something you really have to work at to see through see the humorous nature of the situation. Situation free situation. All right, so yeah, we're gonna just get to 2 hours. We've gotten 12 o'clock here. We'll get to 2 hours on the video. Nice. Maybe I just keep going. I don't know. No script. When the bell hits, tolls midnight, you don't have to stop, do you? I'm not gonna turn into a pumpkin. I told Trump you should get your own television channel. Really? Seriously? He should. He has the money for it. Just do your own cable channel. Yeah, you know what? A lot of people would watch that, like some reality show, you know, just cover the campaign. A ton of people would rather watch that than the junk that's on television and other channels. It was just absolute junk. The people are so plastic. I think they're made of plastic, literally. You know, these can't be real people, can they? It's impossible. Just get your own TV channel, and you'd have a bigger audience than any of these other channels, actually. Only problem is, nobody will advertise. They're too afraid. Corporate culture, they're too afraid. Stupid. They should be able to get some advertisers. Or maybe it could be subscription or something, you know, but my gosh. No, I wouldn't watch it either because I got something better to do, you know, but it just shows you don't put new wine into old wines. Don't even bother going through the mainstream media or, you know, whatever there is. Just have your own TV channel, which is what we got right here, you know. We got a Jesus channel, a Christ Clarity channel right here. No commercials. Thanks to YouTube. Yeah, it's always good to realize that even in our folly, you know, we still manage to not be complete screw-ups, you know. But of course, we try to be complete screw-ups. It's just sometimes we fail to be complete screw-ups. We fail to be dead, you know. We're trying desperately to be dead. We're trying to be inauthentic, but occasionally, you know, we kind of have to fake that maybe we are a little bit authentic, to just trying to figure out what is it we need to kill next. You know, we haven't completely figured out how to die, so let us like figure out, you know, what is the vestigial authenticity we have, and let's draw that out in the open, so then we can then crush it. You know, so it's probably like that. So we have a little grace period here where we can express authenticity until they can figure out, okay, so that's authenticity, you know, okay. Now we can, you know, get out the hammers and the tongs and the pitchforks and the torches. The Iron Maidens. And go to work, you know, a new Inquisition. It's time for the new Inquisition. We just had to figure out what it is that we needed to get rid of. So, full stop on the wow. Remember, don't try to judge for truth or judge for authenticity. The less you judge for it, the more that it just is there. Just don't judge against it. You know, this is the thing. Don't be in judgment. Keep your mind out of judgment. So, I'm able to say the stuff I am because I'm not judging it, really. So the less I judge, the more authentic I'm able to become. This is the same with you. Exact same principle. It's not like this principle works for me, but it won't work for you. It works for everybody. Those who say it doesn't work, they're in too much into judgment still. They're still trying to, you know, judge what is true, what is right, what is fair, what is this, what is that, what is good. Let me judge for this. Let me come up, let me argue, let me defend it, let me this, that. And then that puts them into a defensive posture. Anytime you use words at all, you're in defensive posture, actually. So it's very tricky using words, just saying anything like this. I have to keep it light, I have to keep it humorous, I keep bouncing around, I have to keep from getting into a judgmental state of mind, like I'm trapped here, I need to defend this, I need to push this, you know, I need to prove it this to somebody, I need to convince someone of this or that. No, you know, I just keep it light and flowing, and you know, it's just, don't have to judge for it at all. Just don't judge against it. So it is a talent that I've been working on it, you know, for a long, long time, to be able to say anything at all. Otherwise, you know, you can easily feel like you're getting pulled down into judgment. So, you know, words, symbols, concepts, all that stuff, it's capricious, it's arbitrary, entirely arbitrary, actually. What you call something is completely arbitrary. It's completely dependent on the one you're speaking with or dialoguing with to accept what your definition is and agree, okay, I'll agree with that definition. At any point, they can say, well, you know, I don't really agree with that definition, that label. You know, you called this water. I don't really feel like calling it water. I want to call it something else. It doesn't really appeal to me. I don't like the tone of that. I'm saying water. That's not the right tone that I, you know, so. And then, you know, you're immediately put on the defensive. And they say, well, why did you insist on using that tone? That's not right. I mean, that's not fair to me because I don't really like that. And then you're loggerheads just like that, you see. And this is how judgment, you know, tricks us. Tricks us. We get tricked by judgment severely. So do not practice full stop in the wow. No judgment. At any moment, you stop. No judgment. I don't have to have any outcome. Just tell yourself, I don't have to have any outcome whatsoever. Why? Truth is not an outcome. It's never an outcome. It already is all that there is. Our entire being is truth. So it's impossible for us to have an outcome, actually, to reach an outcome. How can we reach what we already are? We cannot. So you don't have to have an outcome. And yet, you still want to communicate this to others. So this is the tricky situation. It's difficult, for sure. So you have to practice suspending judgment. Practice full stop in the wow. Give it real practice. I can say, like, I have no idea what I've just said. This whole video, I have no idea. Completely oblivious to it. So, you know, no outcome. Either positive or negative. When you go into this no outcome phase, what happens? All the negative outcomes have to disappear, right? Because they're denials of what we already are. And so then we're just left with what's authentic, that's all. All the inauthenticity, it lives on judgment. Inauthenticity lives on judgment. Any judgment. Because all symbols, words, etc., it's arbitrary. So it thinks it has a life. It gives it air. It gives it oxygen. Now, there is a way to use words which, you know, lightens the whole situation up, right? There absolutely. But this is an art, you know. And it's an art based on confidence in non-judgment, non-outcome-ness. Or maybe not based on anything. Who's to say, right? Who's to judge? And they keep, you know, a lot of some who are good at this just keep confounding themselves and contradicting themselves constantly, you know. They just what, you know, why are you trying to judge? You said this, and I contradict yourself, said that, and it's designed to help you get out of judgment, really. So just stop trying to judge. You know, I don't need an outcome. I don't need any outcome. Tell yourself this: I'm already free of any need for any outcome. I'm already free of all outcomes. I am already free of all outcomes. Yes, I already know that I'm already free of all outcomes. Now, I can talk like this because I've proven to myself I can do those practice things. I've already proven it to myself, so I know I can do it. There's no question. So this gives me some freedom to express some spiritual humor, etc. Yes, I already know I'm already free of all outcomes. Totally free of all outcomes. It's the same thing as saying I've never been alive. Yes, I already know I've never been alive. What is life but a search for an outcome? The way we're seeing it. So I've never been alive. You know, being alive is not the same as eternal life. You know, eternal life, there's a, you know, what can we say about it? You can't define it. So we say, I've never been alive. You're dropping all definitions of what eternal life is. You stop trying to define it. Even trying to define it as life is, you're still in a defensive position. You're still judging. You're still vulnerable to the ego, you know. And you'll feel like there's still conflict there. So, yes, I already know I've never been alive. I'm the one who's was perfectly never alive. I'm the one who's always been perfectly not alive. There you go. In other words, never defined. I'm the one who's always been perfectly undefined, indefinable. Man, those crickets can go all night, can't they? I wonder when they stop. That's the question. What causes the crickets to stop? Maybe the temperature drops to a certain point, huh? That's probably what it is. The spider. Maybe this is trying to tell me it's going vertical. It's right here in front of the camera right now. It says, hey, go vertical, go vertical. That's what I'm doing. See, I'm just dropping down, then I go back up, go vertical. Keep going vertical. I already know I'm the one that's never been alive. I've never had a life. I already know I've never had a life. I already know I've never been alive. Of course, the whole idea of being alive is it's subject ultimately to death, right? How can we play out the drama of us dying unless there's something that's dying? So the body seems to die. And again, this death is projected upon the body. Body's neutral. Jesus says the body never has to die at all. In fact, it never actually dies at all. It's neutral. But we project death upon it. So I need a, if I need to die, well, first I have to have a life, of course. I have to first be, say I'm alive so that I can die. So like say I've never been alive. That takes the wind out of the ego's sails, right? I've never been alive. I already know that I've never been alive. I've perfectly never been alive. I am the perfect never been aliveness. Yes, I already know I am the perfect never been aliveness. And what does that mean? I have no idea, no judgment. No judgment. See, don't explain to the ego what it means. The ego says, well, that sounds great, but what does it mean? You know? Silence. So you say, I'm neither explaining anything, nor am I not explaining anything. Just full stop in the wow. See, this is the ego will try to bug you and pester you. And you just say, well, I'm neither explaining anything, nor not explaining anything. It's just a complete maybe-ness right now. That's it. And insist on that maybe-ness. So if you think that you're just rejecting the ego's question, say, well, I want to ask you something. It's important. I'm not wrong with that. Just say, I'm in complete maybe-ness right now. This is the spiritual practice the Holy Spirit's suggesting to me. So, I'm not neither explaining or not explaining. It's called full stop in the wow. Neutral maybe-ness. And just insist on that, and you'll find the ego, it can't say anything to that really. Shuts it up. And just rest in that maybe-ness. See, I'm not saying it is, I'm not saying it isn't. Maybe yes, maybe no. And I'm not judging either one of those at all. And this wonderfully quiets the ego. That horrible pressure that you feel, demand for some answers, demand that you answer. You know, and when you try to say, well, I don't want to answer, the ego says, well, why not? It's mean. It's unfair. Why are you doing this? So you just say, I'm neither saying anything, nor am I not saying anything. I'm neither answering nor not answering. Just say that. I'm neither answering nor not answering. Just keep the eye on that spider. The spider's constantly floating around. I've been spending hours here just floating. And the light's hitting it, you know. Just maybe the spider's just in bliss. I hope so. Blissful spider. Doesn't seem to be doing anything, not building a web, not doing anything. It's just floating. The original bungee jumpers, the original skydivers and spiders. So I'm neither answering nor not answering. The ego says, what about the answer to the question? Well, I'm neither answering the question nor not answering it. See? What can the ego say to that? And then use your will to remain in that. I'm neither answering nor not answering. Full stop on the wow, walking together in the wow. Welcome to the apocalypse. Pull up a chair. Start to understand the humor of the apocalypse. It doesn't happen all at once. You know, it's acquired taste. Apocalypse is an acquired taste, actually. So let's acquire the taste for it. You know, and start to say, hey, yeah, wow. I'm neither answering nor not answering. I'm neither following nor not following. This is, I give you permission to say this, absolutely. Apostolic permission to say I'm neither following the apocalypse nor not following it. I'm neither answering nor not answering. Full stop on the wow. Neutral, go into neutral mode. Lets you get used to the wow. Allows the wow, get used to it just without label, attaching any labels to it other than just wow. You know, we don't want to feel completely without pretending. So labels completely without labels. So we'll just use one label. Forget all the rest. That's a good deal, right? You can use one label, forget all the rest. That's a great deal. And then ultimately, you don't even need that one label. So we just say, wow. There's all these bugs and these lights here just hanging out. They're just still as can be. They're just basking in the light and enjoying the evening here. It's awesome. Wow. They're thinking that they found heaven, you know, Nirvana. There's Nirvana here. Where'd the spider go? I don't know. Oh, there it is. It's still hanging out right in front of me. The whole time. It's awesome. Yeah, permission to say I'm neither following the apocalypse nor am I not following it. And this is, I'm just full stop on the wow. And of course, when you do that, you're able to handle the wow of it, you see. If you can't handle the wow of it, you can't follow it, really. This is the whole key to it. You have to realize the wow is there. The wow is there. And speaking of the wow being there, let's see if we can't dial it in here. I don't know if this thing's even responding. So, the wow of it. Just enjoy the wow of it, okay? This is what's important. Enjoy the wow of it. Wow, the spider just went really close. Boom. There you go. Enjoy the wow of it. Enjoy the wow of it. Just imagine, there you are. There's Jesus. He's coming down from the mountains. And you say, hey, Jesus. A big hypostatic union wow for you. first thing he questions, hey, you got it all figured out? You finally figured out that what the hypostatic union is? Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah, sure. Sure, I did. Yeah, what is it? He says, wow. I said, just wow. He says, you got it. You got it. That's it. You got it. It's just wow. That's it. That's all it is. Yeah, I mean, don't we want to know that Jesus is in a good mood? He's coming back. He's not upset. He's not angry. He's in a jocular, joking, happy mood. Absolutely. We certainly hope for that, right? Be sure to eat light meals at night so you can get to your ice cream. Yeah, don't eat a heavy meal. I just eaten like salad, light salad, a little bit of rice on it, a little bit of feta cheese, and not much cucumber, peppers, some oil and vinegar, and I think that's about it. So eat real light, and then you can have some ice cream. You know what else is July good for? Wow. Here comes Jesus down from the mountains. Oh, there he is. Okay, and he says, hey. I've been waiting 2,000 years. Did you finally figure it out? I said, what's that? The hypostatic union? You finally got it? And I said, oh, yeah, I got it. Good, good. What is it? Wow is what it is. Wow. See? Just wow. He says, very great. Now you understand, right? I said, wow, yeah. I neither understand nor do not understand. Full stop in the wow. He says, perfect. You know, bare feet too. Jesus is walking through the Himalayan mountains of ice and the snow with bare feet. See, look at that. A light tunic or whatever there. And then bare feet. How about that? The rocks. You know, look at all those rocks. Granite rocks. Not even any sandals, I don't think. Just bare feet. It shows the world doesn't, you know, touch him really, right? He can walk through those mountains. There you see. Walk down from those mountains in bare feet. How do you like that? See, that's pretty cool, right? Jesus just walking down from the top of the Himalayan mountains like this in bare feet. And just a simple, you know, basic, I don't know what you call it, tunic, but robe or whatever. Yeah, bare feet and this light dress. Like this, and it's not a problem. Seems to be very relaxed, not bothered at all. The temperature doesn't bother him. The roughness of the stones, the snow, the ice, whatever. It's just nothing bothers. So we say, "Wow, this is amazing." Hey, the software behaved tonight. That's great. You never know what it's going to do. Listen, just wow, 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 wow. Now, if I can dig up what was the previous one that I laid out here. I never know where it is. There it is. So let's go from wow to the first graphic I put up of Jesus down from the mountains. Down from the mountains. And whoops. How did that happen? I have no idea. It's not behaving right now. Let me go back to... This is completely misbehaving. That's okay. I think it's decided it's not going to show any more graphics. Maybe it will. From wow to clarity is what we're trying to get, but maybe it's having a little joke at our expense here, which I think it is. it's not going so well. So it says one graphic is enough for the evening. Very great. We had the clarity last night, so I have to have the wow tonight. So yeah, the graphics have just stopped showing up. So it did get buggy for us. Wonderful. Wonderfully unpredictable. So how are we doing? We're just rolling along here. All right, so this is a good time to realize that we've done enough. Had our exercise, had our workout, developing a sense of humor. You see, the more this gets into you, the more you say, hey, I can, yeah. So make sure you have your popcorn, and your lemonade, your chair, and enjoy the show. Enjoy the show. See, in this way, you realize I'm not really stuck in the show. It is just a show. And become less and less worried about your destiny, your future. People say, why don't you have a smartphone? I say, well, you know, there's no technology in my future at all. So I'm just preparing for my future. Why should I be involved in something that's very soon and not going to have anything at all to do with it, do with me? So now I'm just getting ready for a tech-free future, that is for sure. Tech-free destiny. How cool is that? How wonderful will that be? All right. Looks like that's it. Thanks for watching. And stop the catcher. Are you ready to stop? Everyone's ready to stop. Full stop in the wow. I'm neither answering nor not answering. Remember, the ego tries to knock on your door. Hey, I got a question. I just say, hey, I'm neither answering questions nor am I not answering them. That's my position. The ego just neutralizes it just like that. Neutralizes it. It's just not there anymore.